There are many different ways to collect data, but the two main branches are observational studies and experiments. So we're going to talk about those two branches as well as some layers to each of them. One sort of observational study is called anecdotal evidence. It's from a single or small number of results, often unusual cases. These are usually outliers. So anecdotal evidence, an anecdote is something that someone tells you. So it's like a friend telling you that, hey, I've been taking fish oil and now I can run faster. It's awesome if that's what's working for them, but it would be better to hear it from an actual study with a larger sample size. So with these, we don't really want to trust anecdotal evidence. However, it is a type of observational study where you can hear data, you can observe data, but since it's such a small sample size, it is not to be trusted. So we kind of started with the worst case there. Next is observational studies. So in an observational study, researchers gather data without interacting with the subjects. So this means they're not manipulating anything. Key here is that they only observe. They watch and record. Two forms of observational studies. One is retrospective, which is after the events have taken place. Which means this is usually historical data. So maybe revisiting some records or reading through some past evidence, that would be a retrospective observational study. A prospective observational study is as the events occur. And this is where they are at the location, they observe the results, and simultaneously record. So they're there to do the observation and the recording for prospective observational studies. So with both of those, the researchers, all they're doing is writing down information. They don't have any other effect on the subjects. Randomized experiments is where the researchers have an effect. It's where the researchers can manipulate the environment of the subjects. So they might change something to see if there's some effect. So part of this, we call it controlled. We'll have something called a control group within this experiment. We have it be randomized. When we make our groups, we want to use randomization, which we'll talk about a little bit more. And then they also assign a treatment. This is what they're manipulating in the environment, whether they're giving a drug or playing classical music or wearing red. If they're changing something to see the effect on the subjects, that's going to be their treatment. And then they measure this response variable, what they're recording that they want to see changed. So we're going to look through four examples here and try to figure out which of these values go where. If you want to, you can pause the video right now and try it out for yourself. I'm going to jump into those answers. So in A, we have a group of disabled women age 65 and older. They were tracked for several years, ending in 2010, and they used these results from while they were being tracked. So yes, this is in the past, but since they were being tracked through those years, this is actually recorded at the time. Which means this would be a prospective observational study. So they took for over years, they kept recording this information until 2010, and then they looked at the results. Then in number two, this one has a lot of information to it, but it's all very, very important. So we have the researchers want to investigate whether taking aspirin regularly reduces the risk of heart attack. So they have 400 people who identify as men, and they were divided randomly, that's a key part, into two groups. one group that takes the aspirin and the other group that takes a placebo. And then at the end of the study, they have their results. So this random separation, and then the fact that they're giving a group aspirin, so they're administering a treatment, this is going to be our randomized experiment. So this will be number 4. But some important pieces that are coming through here is we have these two groups that were randomly assigned. And random assignment is very important for our experiments because you don't want the people to choose which group they go into. Generally, that brings in variables that change the data. So we want random assignment. We have two groups. There's a treatment group, which is the group receiving the aspirin. And we have a control group, which is the group not receiving the aspirin. And another important piece to an experiment is a placebo, which is just a fake treatment. So in this case, a group was given a placebo. It's probably something that looks exactly like aspirin. So they would think they are taking aspirin and they just want to see if there's any effect. What can often happen with humans is just the act of taking something each day can make us think that we're feeling better, or it can have all sorts of other effects that aren't actually the pill itself. So this is where they want to check for placebo effect of, is it just the act of taking the pill, or is it actually the aspirin that's having an effect? In C, we have researchers who examined health records. So this is old data that they're looking through, and they're finding information from it. So this is going to be our retrospective. So since they're not actually recording this information, they're just reading old records, that makes it retrospective. And then in D, we have a doctor who worked with two patients whose depression was cured with vitamin B12 injections. Well, that small sample size is going to make it anecdotal evidence. Now again, it's awesome that their depression was cured from vitamin B12 injections. However, it only happened in two patients. We'd want to see a much larger study to actually start making claims. So, in part C above, is it correct to conclude that shorter men are at a higher risk of dying from a heart attack? So in C, that's where it was the historical records, and they saw this information where there tended to be a relationship. However, this is observational data. They just recorded information, which this conclusion that they're making here, this is a causation statement. It's stating cause and effect. It's saying this thing happened, so this thing has to happen. Shorter men are at a higher risk of dying from a heart attack, which is a very strong statement to make. And with observational studies, any observational study, the answer is always going to be no in terms of claiming cause and effect. So for A, C, and D, we can't claim any cause and effect because with observational studies, there's these things called lurking variables. It's this variable that's not connected to the two that we're looking at. So like in this case, we were looking at height and risk of heart attack. It means there might be this third variable that's actually connecting the two. It's probably not just height causing heart attacks. It's probably something else where shorter men have a certain piece of their heart built away. I'm making this up completely, but there might be something else in the anatomy that's actually causing the heart attack. It's not exactly the height. So a lurking variable is a different variable that could be connecting the two. So we want to be careful of these lurking variables because it's outside of the data that we're looking at. And with that, we want to avoid these cause and effect scenarios. The one that we can claim cause and effect is with B. With B, where we have random assignment, treatment and control group, placebo is being administered, we have so much control over that experiment. That's why it's called a controlled randomized experiment. And with that, we can claim cause and effect. We can claim cause and effect because of the control causes minimal lurking variables. So with each piece that we made, we were eliminating lurking variables. With that first step of random assignment, by randomly separating the groups, took out any lurking variables of them choosing which group to go into. Having a treatment group versus a control group, we can actually compare the treatment to what if we did nothing, and that gets rid of any sort of lurking variables. And then a placebo gets rid of a lurking variable of placebo effect. So with all of this control, we're just stripping away all of those possible lurking variables, and we get more control, which means we can start claiming cause and effect, which is a very powerful statement that can only come through with experiments, never observational studies. And if we do it with experiments, it should be well designed. If it doesn't have these key features that we're looking for, which we'll talk about in a future video, then we want to be careful of this claim of cause and effect.